think we maybe some more will join us during the talk and Julian's presentation. But I think we can start, and it's nice seeing all of you here. And my name is Andreas, and I'm the co-founder of Tingent. And I think most of you are familiar with Tingent, but in short, we are an agency helping our customers find the right freelancers and consultants for their needs within IT. And today we both have some customers, I think, and also freelancers from our network listening in. And for us, it's all about relationships and connecting people. And that's why we have invited you here today to listen to our friend Julian Visconti. And he's a freelancer we have on an assignment at Spotify at the moment. And he has prepared a presentation for you all called Scaling a Startup on Google Cloud. And if you have any questions during the presentation, you can use the chat and type them there, and Julian will try to answer them. And also at the end, I think we'll have some Q&A. But with that said, and without further ado, here is our hero of the day, Julian Visconti.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me fine? Just thumbs up if you can hear. Perfect. Great. Can you see the screen as well? I cannot see you, so I have to. Okay, everybody can see. Perfect. So welcome and thank you for coming to this presentation. I'm going to talk about scaling on GCP. A bit of a warning. It's impossible to teach you everything that there is to know about scaling in less than an hour. So I would highly recommend that if you have questions, I will check the chat for question and answering in between the slides. So feel free to use them. All right, here we go. So who am I? I'm a software engineer. I specialized in Google Cloud. I also have like a few certifications, as you can see here. And the reason I put them there is because, like, if you have a question in those area, feel free to ask them to me. I will be very happy to help you with that. If you have also interest into the previous talk I made, they're all on the website. You should have received the link to the slide. If not, I can quickly paste it into the chat, so you have them as well, and you can follow along if the video doesn't suit you. So yeah, what are we going to talk about today? I'm going to make an introduction about what is scaling and why we need to scale. I'm going to talk a little bit about scaling code, and I'm going to talk a little bit about scaling teams, which is a much bigger topic, I think. I will, at the end, draw some conclusion of, you know, what I learned during all those years of scaling, you know, to some high load services. And I will give you some resources, such as a book or some reference. So, first of all, I have come up with a new term called UIQWAD, and it means unless you know what you're doing. So when you hear the terms UIQWAD, you understand that I don't mean this is the law and you should follow it and everything else is wrong. It's more like, yeah, unless you understand the trade-off that you're making, maybe you should follow that guideline. And so what does it mean to scale? Well, let's talk about like the three ways you can scale. So you can scale either vertically, meaning that if an application consumes a lot of resources, you can add more CPU or RAM or disk. You can scale horizontally, meaning that you add more instances of the same application to handle more load in parallel. Or you can scale deeply, which is like a service that calls a service that calls a service that calls a service. And that depth is the most complex, I should say, of all the scaling you can find, because you cannot keep all the permutation in your head. And so if you think about it, think about, you know, let's take the place people live, like a village. It's 100 people, there's probably more animals than there is people there. They have some infrastructure, maybe some road, maybe even a light on the road. And, you know, those kind of things are real well suited for that 100 people. You know, they don't really need more. it's convenient enough. But once you move to a city, which is like 10,000 people living there, they have a completely different need, different architecture, different infrastructure. And even more so, if you move to a mega city, I'm thinking like Tokyo, New York, where 10 million people live there, imagine the scale of those things. Even though they serve the same purpose, they are not the same thing. They don't have the same need, and they are not exactly handled the same way. So it's always the same in computer when you scale. It looks the same. It might serve the same purpose, but it's a completely different system. And that's the point of this talk, is that at scale, you're going to have problems that are completely different than when you don't have scale, which kind of makes sense. And so the first question you can ask yourself is when to scale. When to scale is when you have a bottleneck somewhere. If you do not have a bottleneck, if you're not blocked in some way, in some hard limit, this is not a scaling problem. Like if you can buy more RAM or CPU, this is usually the best way to go about it, or the fastest way to go about it, because engineer time are usually more expensive than whatever hardware you have. And so if you don't have a bottleneck but still want to scale, it's more like you have a people problem. Like it's a joke about, they call it the cloud meat, is when you don't automate anything, and so you add more people to the cloud to make it work permanently. But yeah, usually it depends which problem you're trying to solve. If you don't have a bottleneck, scaling is no point for that. And so for a startup with a product, a serverless architecture is actually a really good place to start, unless you know what you're doing. But the idea is that you want to focus on the really on the product, on the business side of things. You don't really want to build, you know, a whole cloud infrastructure if you don't even have customers. So scaling before you have actually clients is not such a good idea, but of course, unless you know what you're doing. And think about serverless as the same way as Wi-Fi, which is at some point you're going to hit a wire. But the experience you have is that you don't really see that wire, or you don't entirely care about it. And that's more the idea of serverless. And so what I hear often people say is that we should build our own X. And X could be anything non-related to the business, which is, for instance, a framework, an in-memory database, a queue system, or, you know, some new programming language, or DSL. And this is where the drain of all the time, of all the engineer power goes into. No question still. So the better answer is we could build it, but spending time on the business makes more sense financially. You know, it's many companies have weighted the pros and cons of building something because, you know, the cost of maintaining something is also has to be included in the price. And I would say like one of the best repo you can find is called No Code, made by Kelsey Hightower. I highly recommend that that repository. And it goes like this. No code is the best way to write secure and reliable application. Write nothing, deploy nowhere. Getting started, start by not writing any code. And that's the way to scale. This scale very much. No code go scale to infinity, actually. And that's a really good start. And that's what I want to mean. I want to... It's more like the idea of maybe you don't need to scale. I'm trying to dissuade you to scale because the problem you're going to have, I'm not sure that you fully grasp how complicated and difficult it is. And so it's all about trade-off, right? You have developer time versus using a product, it's build or buy. If you have on-premise, you know, you don't want to use the cloud, yeah, you have fixed price and, you know, you can do capacity planning, or the cloud, you can pay for what you use. Or if you use serverless, you have latency versus throughput. And some people complain about the cold start, but I feel like if you have customer, usually you don't have that problem. So problem solved. And all that depends on your strategy. So your strategy starts with the customer at the top. So this is the value on the y-axis, the value you provide to the customer. And on the x-axis is the time or the evolution. And you can see that the more on the left side of the graph you are, the more innovative it is. meaning that you cannot find a service that's going to sell something to you. You have to build it yourself, or you have to invent and do research to build something yourself. And the more on the right of the graph, it's more like, well, something like a commodity, like power, or and you, I don't know about you, but if you start a company using, starting by, hey, we should build our own electricity generator, is probably not the first thing that comes to mind. So those kind of commodity are outsourced, and very much so, because they are very common. And all that mapping is something that I highly recommend you look into. Like you weigh the pros and cons of what actually do you need? What can you buy? Does it make sense to buy something? How fast can we get to market to that? And those are business decisions that are driven by a strategy. And it all comes down to that, because the technology is only a tool that the business use to provide a service. And if you ever end up in going to the cloud and saying, you know what, we build our own distributed system, these are some of the numbers that I find are quite optimistic sometimes. So you can, you know, learn to use a managed service. That's going to take 1 or 2 weeks. If you want to build an entire cloud architecture, that's going to take 6 to 24 months. I think that's when you don't have any legacy, like when you start from scratch. Think about it. It takes 2 years when you start from scratch to go to the cloud. What will be the service in the cloud that will be available in 2 years? If you look at 2 years back, what was available, what is available now? And imagine in 2 years' time, what would be available? And so if you have to do a migration, I mean, I'm sorry to disappoint you, but this is more like a 5-year plan. And after 5 years, you can say, yeah, we fully migrated. And I'm not even sure that it's always the case, because it has just so much legacy and we can only do so much, right? If you want to know more about those numbers, I put the link in the of the talk I stole it from, made by Evgeny Berkman. And so this is a very interesting paper that I find researching chaos engineering. It's only 32 pages long. It's actually quite a short read, and it's pilot error experience in operating aircraft controls. So what they did is they analyzed the errors that pilots after the Second World War were doing to understand how can they build better planes. And there is one type of error that is really interesting. It's called substitution error. And it's when you operate the wrong control as a result of a failure to identify a control properly, meaning that the dashboard were not the same depending on the plane. So if you change plane, the pilot had to figure out where is the altitude, where is that gauge, or where is that number that I'm looking for. And so they were so confused. And when you're up there fighting for your life, it means really that you have to it's almost muscle memory. You cannot figure stuff out when you're in the air combat. And what they did, simply, they standardized the dashboard, not the plane, the dashboard of the plane. It means that overnight, 50% of all the errors the pilot were making were gone, just for that simple thing. Imagine how you build your tools, and remember that part when you build your tools, because if you make a standardized way to do something, it might not cover every use case, but it will remove half of the error that you could potentially make. All right, so do we have any, what does cold start mean? Good point. So cold start, it's when you use a serverless function, you have to call it and it gets spun up, and you only pay for when it gets used. The cold start is when it's not used for a long time, and so it takes a little bit longer to get it activated or to respond. That's what we call the cold start problem. And the way to keep that, to prevent that function from going cold start, is to keep calling it. And if you have a lot of customers, usually your function don't have the time to cold start. So it's a little bit of a non-issue kind of. So this is one of the questions I get the most asked after, can I get a free subscription at Spotify? But should we use Kubernetes? And my answer is always the same, is no. And the reason I say no is not because Kubernetes is, you know, about technology. Quite the contrary, Kubernetes is amazing. People don't appreciate how amazing Kubernetes is. I say no because it's the wrong question. You should not say, should we use Kubernetes? It's like, is Kubernetes good for our use case? Because our use case is. And there we can talk about, you know, does it fit your use case or not? Because to be honest, most of the time, Kubernetes does not fit the use case at all, but they still go full on to that. And then they drown into the amount of tooling and you know, help that they need to have in order to build a fully scalable cluster with stateful, you know, application and everything. So it gets quite tricky really fast because distributed systems are hard. I know, shocker. But so this is my 2 minute explanation of Kubernetes. Kubernetes, it's a database that gets that remember the state of your cluster. It remembers what runs where, and that's about it. And the only way you interact with this database is through an API. And this API, they use, like, you can define some YAML, and with a tool, it converts that to JSON and send in to HTTP through this API server. It's a typical backend with a database. And in that database, what you can do is there is a control manager that checks how much is in the cluster for real and how much you want to see. And it reconciles those numbers. So if you have like three instances of your application and you want five, it will automatically spawn up two. If you have like five and you should have three, it will automatically kill two. And you don't have to care about where it runs. That's the beauty of Kubernetes, is that this is scalable because you have a very narrow set of things that you should focus on, which is your application basically. So remember, Kubernetes is a database and treat it as such. It manages the state of your cluster. And of course, you know, with your application, you have the deployment, but those you still need to code your application as a 12-factor app. So it means that with containers, you can deploy easier. You can, you know, have some kind of reproducible build. It's not 100%, but it gets much better than whatever dependency management you might have. And so the reason I talk about this is if you don't choose to go serverless, full on serverless, you can still use containers with a simple web server that are used for services like Cloud Run, which are, you know, really amazing if you get started. But of course, this is the kind of the problem that you have with those containers, right? How do I scale them up and down? How to provide redundancy? Where to schedule them? How can they talk to each other? How to handle secret and, you know, rolling version and everything. And this is what this all of these are the problem Kubernetes solve for you. If you don't have those problems, well, you don't really need Kubernetes. Okay, it might be like in the future you need, but, you know, take it when it comes or make a plan or make a strategy about, okay, when are we going to need that? But of course, Kubernetes does not solve everything because, for instance, Kubernetes doesn't tell you how to solve your logging problem or how to do failover or how to visualize your dependency, how to do tracing. And all those things are, you know, usually developer use code to do that. For that, I have to put, like, if you do microservices and you use logging, this is the way the cost of logging is going to kill you way before any technical limit occurs. Because imagine you have like one application, you split it in two. Now suddenly your logs, you have to log twice as much because the part you have to send a message, you have to log that you received the message, you have to, and so this is exponential the more services you have. So in a distributed system, if you lose logging as debugging, you're going to drown in the cost of that. And really, way before you have any kind of technical limit. And just make an exercise, like see how many applications you have, the cost of network and storage, and how much days you keep those. And you're going to see that you spend probably more on logging and debugging than actually on running the application, which is insane. So what is the solution then? Well, logging is basically an immutable event, but you don't want to see like an event, a single event. You want to see the context of that event, what happened before, what happened after. And so this is where tracing comes. If you have a distributed system, you need tracing, not logging. If you have to use logging to debug things, it gets 10 times harder because you have to see and remember what is that service and try to match the timestamp, hoping that they are synchronized and all those things. Like, you don't want to do that. Tracing, it will let you see the behavior of the whole system. It will give you the critical path your customer use, and you can have some of the visualization. You have something concrete to reason about. It's much easier. It will not solve all your problem, but it will narrow your problem down to where is your bottleneck. Because if you have a bottleneck, doesn't matter how much you work before or after, your bottleneck is still going to limit the whole pipeline. So this is why it's important. And of course, Google Cloud provides you this tracing functionality. You still need to pass a correlation ID in the code to be able to see those things, but it's not that hard to instrument your code. It's painful because it's easier than just say log dot debug and leave everything on debug mode even in production to see what happened, and then suddenly you have like 30 teams doing that and the cost just explode. But here you can see that you have to see the whole critical path. And now that you isolated the trace at the service, there you can see if there is some log into it. That's much better because it reduced the load on the system. And so when talking about observability, I think this is really one of the things I highly recommend to start early, is to know what's going on into your system. And so, implement some site reliability engineering practice. Do chaos engineering practice, chaos experiment is actually something really, really valuable if you understand. But for doing those things, you need to have a good monitoring. You need to see what happened. If you don't know what happened, if you don't understand what is the behavior or the reaction of the system given certain input, it's kind of pointless. But with that, you can actually mix more data. So now it's become more like I'm using that many services. How can we optimize that? How can we, use data to make informed decision about our finance? Or, is that service worth building, or should we buy that one? And it's all those things I mean, they will give you so much information. It will reduce the guessing work, and you will feel much more confident about your system. And that feels good because it's less stress. One warning sign, though, is those hippie company that decide that, every team should choose their own languages and they should all, sing Kumbaya around the fire. They can do whatever they want. But if you have more than three languages in your company, this is really a pain point, because for every language, you have to re-implement how to instrument code, how to do, those retries, all the networking stuff and all the debugging experience has to be reinvented for each languages. And that's a real, real pain point. Remember those dashboard with the airplane? It's better to have one language to rule them all, even though it's not the most performant, but, it will make people performant. And so if you think about it, like, the code containing your business logic is, I have a question. How does one do tracing without logging? You don't, actually. The log, you have to be mindful about the log that you embed into the trace. So you can use logging. I don't say like, don't, it's more like UIQAD, unless you know what you're doing. But I used to work at a company that we had services that handled 50,000 requests per second. If you log at that rate, you just kill your budget in a day or two. So we were not allowed to log. And the way we solve it is by writing a lot of tests. So we knew what could fail. We were only logging if there is an error, meaning actually our logging was more alerting. So if we see a log, it means somebody had to investigate that one. The third thing is that with tracing, you actually is you are more mindful of embedding what do you need to see, what do you want to see in a production, and not turn on, flip on all the switch and see like, okay, I have to query some in a really weird language to try to find my logs, and there is just so much log, it doesn't even make sense anyway. I'm never gonna read all of that. And half of it is stack trace error that, you know, it makes no sense, or that some libraries that just spit out some log. It's really not efficient. Here, it's more like when you scale, you have to be mindful of those things. And so logging, using to debugging your system or to understand the bottleneck is almost impossible to do, or it's way too expensive. That's the point I was trying to make. I hope does that answer a question. But now I'm continuing with the presentation. So if you count the code containing business logic versus all the rest, you have to think about total cost of ownership, because you have your Kubernetes manifest, your Docker image, your configuration file, all the code related to networking, saving, communicating to database, the dependency, and the list goes on and on. So actually the business logic, it's a really, really small amount. And so that's what I mean from the beginning of the presentation. Like, you know, if you're a startup, serverless is kind of like the way to go, because unless you know, it's really, if you have a product like a website or you're selling something, it will save a lot of time, and it's better to outsource that to some other company that are specialized into solving those problems, because the total cost of ownership is something that is kind of like, it's more like an art form to calculate. But if you think about it, restaurants buy, cook, and sell food. Very few do farming, and even less are good at both. And it's true, like how diversified do you need to be? If you think about like a software engineer, doesn't really need to know all that stuff. Like, and when you're hiring, like how do you measure how much a person should know? Because those people who can do both, like, you know, DevOps and software engineering and knowing like three languages and those things, they get pretty rare, you know, and they might not want to work for you if you don't have like an interesting problem to solve. So it very much like specializing into something is kind of like a good strategy. And I want to read this tweet by Mr. Mohapatra, which is the person who built the physical data center of Google. He says, so Lyft is paying $8 million a month to AWS, almost $100 million a year. Each ride costs 14 cents in AWS rent. I keep hearing they could build their own data center and save. My early days at Google Cloud, I heard the same from customers. At scale, owning is cheaper. It wasn't. They all came around. Here is why. I put the link of the whole thread, but basically, this is like a whole thread about understanding the total cost of ownership. If you build your own data center, this is like, your job is not to build data center. It's probably to sell a product. I understand that sometimes you need to for regulation purposes or else, but the cost of that might be so much to get something even like remotely good, like good enough, it's really hard. And you might need some specialized people to come and fix the problem for you, which might end up costing more at the end. So total cost of ownership is quite something to work on that I recommend to practice, because it will pay off with your strategy. So, okay, we talk about scaling now. We scale the compute, memory, storage, networking. What would be missing in there? And that's really what nobody talks about. And that's security. And that's the real cloud locking. Because it doesn't matter. Your compute will run. You know, you have a computer, it will run there. But security? How do you migrate that? If you move from one cloud to another, they don't even have the same degree of granularity for your security. So this is the real cloud lock-in. And so if you want to see on Google Cloud how they build, is you have this organization that you can divide into folders, that you can divide into projects that contains those resources. And on every layer, you can tell if a person, a group, or a service account has access or some role that gives them some access under it. And I feel like this is great when you're a 10,000 employee company That might work for you. For a startup, this is a death penalty, because you can be sure if you do like that, team B is never going to know what team A is doing. And it's all going to be, they're all going to reinvent the wheel in their own little team and never talk to each other. It's very dangerous to try to architect something that is so precise that you can never change it after. And that's the thing, because a startup evolve, and what you need to do is to evolve with them. And with security, because I don't know if you looked at the news recently, like there is data breach and people get hacked like on a weekly basis. And so for startup, it's important to start this monitoring of security early on, because it's kind of hard to do it after. And keep it simple, because simple scale. And so, yeah, you have different level of access. And those access will be, of course, we might change, especially if you actually your startup gets, you know, serious. And now suddenly you have to go to IPO or sell, you know, selling shares to the public. Suddenly you have like audits that are coming. You have to need audit log. You have to restrict access. You need to do background check on some people. It's a whole new game that you're into. And to be part of those audit, I can tell you it's not as hardcore as it seems, but there are some basic principles that you need to start following from the get-go. Like you should know who's using what, when, where. And that simple question is gonna, you know, drive your security roadmap. Because after that, it's gonna get easy to add people, it's gonna be easy to remove people from access. So okay, we done like compute, memory, storage, security, but again, what's missing when we talk about scale? Well, data, because, you know, I don't know if any of you went to open a bank account or took a loan at the bank. I'm pretty sure you didn't ask what's are the security model or what is the tech stack. You just went with the bank that has the best loan or the interest rate or whatever seems good for you, not how they do it. And data is kind of the same. You know, nobody cares about your code, nobody cares about your tech stack, but you, because you have to deal with that. But your customer, they couldn't care less what kind of framework you use, or, you know, if you're logging or not, or, you know, all they want is the service that you provide and the price that you give, that they have to pay for it. And so, you know, scaling database, it's one of the, I would say, hardest problem, because you cannot just press pause and restart kind of with data. So the easiest way is just to add more CPU or RAM. If you want to, and follow that in that order, you know, optimizing queries, okay, it's a bit complicated, but it can be done. If you want to, if you have too much load on them, you can make read replica, meaning that the data is replicated across more than one database and they are just used for read, while the write I use in a single, in a kind of like the leader position of all the database. And if you reach some point that, you know, the scale becomes so huge, you cannot handle that with a read replica, you have to think about sharding. And that one, I think the level, like it's a tenfold level of complication in regard, the complexity regarding your code and how you handle that. Because if you can avoid that one, this is like, I would highly recommend, you know, outsourcing something to a database or a company that has a database that scale. Because the managing that is kind of a full-time job. Unless you want, you like to do those things. So that's good. So unless you know what you're doing. And yeah, on GCP, they are kind of that, those databases that scale really well. And they, you know, the documentation tell you how to scale them. That's why I don't go too much into details, because probably in 6 months, there's going to be a new feature that are, you know, allow you to scale even further. Like your Google Cloud Spanner, you have like transaction planet scale. Or BigQuery, you can query petabyte of data in a matter of minutes. Those things are really insane. Or if you want to see like everything, you can use something like Data Studio to see like all the commit that has been done, or how often those commits are made, or, you know, all your services, how many errors, or calculate the cost, like how much you spent into compute last month or per hour. So that if you know how much you bring by customer or, you know, per hour, and you know how much your infrastructure costs per hour, you can easily calculate you know, how much you're making and how much downtime will cost you. So then you can make a prediction and allocate a budget with, you know, people to improve that reliability. And that makes sense because it's a fulfilling, self-fulfilling prophecy. The more you practice that, the better you're going to get at it. And of course, if you want to do AI at scale, you have like a Kubeflow if you want to run your own, or you have the AI platform, which is like an improved version of Kubeflow with cloud integration, which is really nice. I mean, I had to set up Kubeflow once. I would prefer to use the platform. Also, for security, you can use Forseti if you're on Google Cloud, because this is kind of like a scanner that query all the GCP API of your cloud organization, and they store that in a database that you can actually see what you have. Because if you give total ownership to your total ownership to the team, they might start creating things, and you might want to have some of the data that what they're doing, so you can provide information about, hey, maybe, you know, we don't need to create so many services. Maybe that makes sense to have a team solve that problem once and for all. And otherwise, you can use the cloud asset inventory. It does the same thing. Okay, so we talk a lot about, you know, scaling code and what it means, you know, and all the trick that you're going to have to remember. But the main idea is really, if you can avoid it, you keeping things simple will really help. But if you can't, you know, and you still have to deal with, okay, we need more people. This is kind of like having to automate things makes that scaling people less of a problem, because, you know, if you automate, you don't need that many people to manage things. But that's just my personal opinion. So if you have to scale people, let's say that you're 12 person, and 6 months later you are 50. What is the culture gonna look like? Who is gonna do the hiring process? What kind of people do you want to hire? And all those questions are gonna come on top of your scaling problem. So it depends really how you want to handle that. Learning new skills. I truly believe that, you know, if we don't have a purpose, or just throwing a learning platform at employee and hoping that they will finally learn something, I think this is wishful thinking. I don't believe that that's how we learn. I believe we learn by doing and making things and in improving and playing with things. Also, the onboarding process. If it takes 6 months for a newcomer to be productive, you better have a really good retention policy or keeping them longer, because otherwise it's just, you know, you paid someone to learn something that doesn't bring you any value. Also, regarding communication tools, if you have more than three chat app, good luck finding who said what to whom. And also, it took me a while, but at Spotify, I met like really impressive people in the management. I mean, brilliant, brilliant people. And they come to the conclusion that management is there to set clear objective. So if you don't know what you should work on, it's probably your management task to answer that question. And if they don't know how to answer that question, they should make plans for being able to answer that question. And also, when scaling people, finance is a really, really tough sell, because finance is still living in the 80s. Like, it's still everything going manually. It's really hard. If you want to have like a well-functioning company, like dedicating some engineer to automate that financial thing is really going to pay off. So now we're reaching to the conclusion. And the conclusion I have is basically that a tool won't fix a bad process. And automating that bad process makes it automatically worse. Time is money, really. If you have to build or buy something, that's a decision. Or just don't do it. It's maybe that's a good question to ask. What's the cost of not doing something like that? Document your architecture decision, because for sure you're not going to remember why things are the way they are. And it's good to remind ourselves, you know, time to time about, you know, why we made some of the decision, and just assume that you're going to be wrong. Just know that you just document those wrong decision to be able to change them later. And this is not like the gospel, and they're not set in stone. People can change it. And microservices are meant to ship your organization chart. It means that there is no company that has a monolith with 200 developers hammering on it and still have, can be able to ship feature fast. So microservices are there to scale people, basically. It's when you have too many people and they need to be able to work on to shipping feature in your organization. And also work on your monitoring and know your bottlenecks and be aware of your limit. Do some chaos engineering. Do some, challenge the status quo of your system, testing, and starting early from securing and managing access from the beginning is one of the best decisions you're going to make, especially if, you don't have too many services, but you usually have third party or things like that, and it gets complicated really fast. I would highly recommend that to the way you manage access, you do it early on. And if you have one book that you want to read in order to learn how to scale, this is the one. Designing Data Intensive Application. I can highly recommend that you get that book and you read it. It's quite thick, but it's totally worth your time. I would have saved like days of agony if I had that book when I needed to do like figure all that stuff out. I highly recommend you read it if you need to scale. And also that paper from Google that is shifting left on security. It's very much, I don't know if you've seen the news, how many company get hacked because of a supply chain attack, because they're pulling dependency from the internet written by strangers, and then they wonder how they get hacked. It's really important that we try to solve that problem. And thank you. And as always, because I wrote way too much code in my life that I care to admit, I'm sorry if you had to maintain my code, and I hope that you learn more by maintaining it than me by writing it. If you have any question, feel free to contact me. I'll be happy to answer, and all the presentation and slide are going to be on the website bisconti.cloud. Thank you for your attention. Do you have any more questions? Going once. Going twice. You're welcome, Andreas. My pleasure.
Yeah, thank you, Julian. Much appreciated.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for inviting me. If you don't have any question or you don't have any use case that you want me to review.
We can definitely collaborate in the future.
My pleasure. Yes, sure. I'm here for that.
We are in this trip right now of setting up our first site reliability engineering team while developing our infrastructure in Google Cloud. And I like very much what I saw, and it shows that we are on the right path. And we have sidetracked a bit, but there are important learnings for us. For example, the identity and access management part, that it's good to get it right in the first place. While sometimes you have to find the balance of making quick decisions and delivering something. So it's the time that it bites us back right now.
Yeah, definitely. I can, and it's good to read those site reliability engineering book. They are freely available on the web from Google. They also give a lot of a lot of lessons of what went wrong, and I think that we learn more about what went wrong than if you look how something went right, you just say of course it went right, but usually what went wrong is something completely unusual, or you could not. I can tell you a story about that. So we had a Redis cluster, And we had one customer that was hammering that cluster really hard. So the data was sharded. And we had this auto-scaling of the application. The problem is that customer started really, you know, was bringing a lot of traffic. So what the application did was scale. The problem is the key of the customer was used into the key of the database. So, you know, it was always hitting the same database. And at some point we scaled so much that the machine didn't have any more port left. So the error was we ran out of port. Nobody could have figured that one out, you know, or can think like, hey, you know what? At some point, you're going to run out of port by querying too much your database. And you know, that's why I really an advocate of chaos engineering is like, you know, test your backup, do something, just know how your system work. One task that I give people usually that is really easy is you can go to Google Cloud, create a small Kubernetes cluster, and when you scale your application, see which one gets created first and which one gets killed first. And the reason it's important is because if your application has cache, you have to manage those things and understand how it works. Now do the same, but for VM, Kubernetes node. Add a node and scale down to see which one gets killed first. Those questions, you don't even have them yet. And that's what is hard about chaos engineering, is really like, we don't even know what question to ask, but we're gonna dig in, we're gonna poke the system a bit, we're gonna see if we can stay into our error budget, and we're gonna learn from there and make new hypotheses and, you know, bring more information to the team so that they know how the system works and they can avoid those kind of, you know, horror story where, you know, everybody's running like a chicken without head and wondering why production is down.
Thank you again. If nobody else has any questions, I have one more, but I leave some time in case someone wants to ask. Okay, 3, 2, 1, I go. So, quite interesting the part that you mentioned about the microservice architecture and also the part of scaling the team and the company. So I would like you to, if you have, to share some experiences about the best practices of designing and maintaining microservices within the context of teams.
I would say the first one is to have one language, one programming language. If you have two or three, it's almost impossible to keep up, you know, with all the dependency management, the way libraries are implemented differently. Just settle on one language, choose a boring one if possible, like, you know, a one that has been there for a while. I really like Go, so I'm completely biased towards that, but it's you know, it's not a golden path either. You have problem in Go that are, you know, requires a bit of thinking to solve. The idea here is very much to standardize. Remember the story about, you know, those airplane dashboards? It's kind of the same. You just want to code business logic, truly, right? Nobody says, hey, let's reinvent a networking library for fun. At least I never heard anybody saw that. Or they did it in the spare time and they give up after a week because it was way too hard. And so this is the idea, is to standardize how you manage those services. How do you do tracing? How do you do, you know, fault injection? How do you do, you know, this, how do you create a new service? All of those parts. And it could be as simple as, you know, downloading a repo, cleaning the Git, recreating the Git, and modifying some names and stuff. Like, it doesn't need to be super advanced where everything is automated. Just start like simple and dirty and see how fast you can go. Measure things. Create a lot of, you know, work with teams. Ask them what they would like to see. I think that goes a long way about that. It's, there is no silver bullet. like this is the path that you choose. The way of DevOps is if you're not good at something, do it often, you will get better. See, you have to know what are your pain points. If nobody complains, you know, it's like if nobody complains, everything's fine. But sometimes they don't complain, and it's not fine. So it's not really like a silver bullet to say like, yeah, microservices are the way to go. It's more like microservices are meant if you have like tons of people working on your system. And that's about it.
In that case, tons of people working in your system, can you imagine a setup where all those people work independently and do not have to have the knowledge of the product of every other person, every other microservice?
Yeah, and well, I never saw that happen. And I have like a friend during a retrospective, an ex-colleague, he told me, I took this job to avoid talking to people, and I end up talking to people all day long because I need to know what the hell am I calling from, you know, what is happening in this service. It's more like you install something on your computer and it doesn't work. How long before you start digging into it? It's always like that. Like nothing is going to work as you expected, and it's better to have that belief and say, okay, you know, we don't know. We're going to have to know how they do things. And that's why standardization is kind of like a good way, because you don't question things anymore. You know it, that's the standard. That's the way to go. And the problem is that when you change that way to go, you also have to change all the previous one that have been built. So you have a trade-off on what you should standardize or not. But I don't believe that you will ever solve that problem that communication is not needed, because at the end we are human. And the problem with communication is that the bandwidth of talking is actually really, really low. And that's why convention over configuration is better, because it eliminates like a ton of misconception and misunderstanding right from the get-go. The same from those pilot. They didn't remove all the errors, but half of them got gone. So there is a bit of fine-tuning there that you have to find. But mainly like observability, this should be standard. It should be like a checkbox, like, yes, I want to see what happened in my service. That will definitely improve the cost and the usage of the infrastructure for a developer.
Thank you very much.
I can think of another surprising story that I had. I try to forget those, so it's not easy to remember, you know, those kind of things. But it sounds silly sometimes, but we had a two production cluster, one for failover, and somehow sometime we deployed, the latency to the Redis instance was fluctuating a lot. And of course, it was a network cable on one of the cluster that was wrong, that could not reach that Redis instance. You know, like how as a developer, how can you know it's a faulty network cable? You know, I'm a developer, and I've been part of a data center fire, a data center flooding. I've never been into an earthquake of a data center, but I'm sure, hey, I'm not out of the wood yet. A faulty cable, what was that? I've been part of a ransomware attack, of a DDoS attack. All those things are quite, I mean, you're not prepared until it happens to you and you realize, what the hell should we do now? So test your backup, it will relieve you from ransomware. You know, those kind of things you prepare some kind of disaster recovery. What if suddenly Europe West 1 just blew up? Where do you deploy your stuff? How fast can you redeploy your infrastructure? Those are quite fun fire drill, if you ask me. You know, the first time it's going to take like forever. And you, the third time, like most of it is going to be automated. It's going to be awesome. It's such a powerful, like you feel so confident about your system that you say, you know what? Europe can blow up and we will still survive. So that's the kind of power like chaos engineering can do. But if you don't have any more questions, I think we can end the presentation here. Don't hesitate to contact me if you have any questions. You have my website and my information, so feel free.
Thank you so much, Julian.
My pleasure, Matthias.
Thank you very much, Julian. Great presentation.
Thank you, Niklas.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Have a good day, everyone.
Thank you. Have a good day. Bye-bye.
Stay safe. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.